Generative art is an art form where you make the computer draw for you. Now, this is not to be confused with AI art, which I guess is generative art as well, but that's not what we're doing here. Instead, we create a rule set for the algorithm to follow. The computer then randomly draws something based on the given rule set. The rule set can be as simple as drawing a randomly colored and sized squares on the canvas, or as complex as wave function collapse, or even more complex. The possibilities are limitless. I accidentally stumbled upon an extremely versatile system that could be used for generative art in Geometry Dash. There are two features in the 2.2 update that make it possible: the random triggers and the variation slider in different triggers. I originally didn't even intend to create generative art, but I slowly headed that direction on a stream. I had a repeating checkered pattern in my block decoration, and the darkest squares were all one object each. I wanted to optimize this and use as few objects as possible to fill out the pattern, and then the idea hit me.
I just thought of an insane way to do it.
Okay, so we have spawn particle. So I could spawn this object in the very beginning of the level. I could make a loop that just goes up by an entire block until it hits a block here. I could just make collision blocks, and then it goes to the left and goes back down here. And that way I could make all of these squares from just particles, and it would be 20 objects or something. Not long after that, I managed to create a mock-up of the situation in the main level. I then went down a rabbit hole testing the limits of the particle trigger. I kept on iterating and iterating, slowly getting more and more complex creations.
Like, I can just do whatever I want with this. So let's just make it, I don't know, lobotomy faces.
Oh my god.
Variation slider? Yeah, that's what I wanted to try too. Let me make it plus minus 0.5.
Oh my god. You can make a background like this. Oh my god.
After a successful test run on stream, I decided to continue off stream and master this technique, which is what you saw in the intro of this video. So, let's go over how to get started with this. I'll divide this tutorial into three parts: beginner, intermediate, and advanced. The beginner section consists of the basics to get started. The intermediate section will go over more complex trigger work to get more varied results. And finally, the advanced section will be about moving the particles. To start off, place down a particle trigger and change max particles to 1. Set duration and lifetime to 9999 so it doesn't despawn. Set emission to 200 and everything else to 0. In the visual tab, set start size and end size to the same value with 0 variation. In the extra tab, you can use additive, object color and uniform color, however you like. Select any texture you want. Go wild and test different textures. Lastly, put the trigger in group 1. Next, place down a collision block. Set the block ID to group 1 and scale it down a little bit. Put it in the group 2. This is where the particles will spawn. After that, place down a spawn trigger, set particle group to 1 and position group to 2 and make it spawn triggered and multi-triggered. Place a move trigger underneath it that moves group 2. Set move X to some number and move time to 0. Make this spawn triggered and multi-trigger as well. To finish the loop, place a spawn trigger that spawns group 3 with delay 0.0044. Any number below breaks the loop. Make this spawn trigger and multi trigger as well, then select all 3 of the triggers and put them into group 3. Finally, to start the loop, get another spawn trigger that spawns group 3 and make it touch trigger. Now, when touching it, you should get a row of particles. To make the particle go back and forth, place down a wall of collision blocks and make them all block ID 2. And tick dynamic block on. Place down a collision trigger before the starting line and set block A and B ID to 1 and 2 and target ID to 4. tick on the activate group setting. Next, place down a move trigger underneath with group 4. Set its target group ID to 2 and turn on spawn trigger and multi-trigger. Make the move time 0. Move X and move Y is how much the particle spawner moves after colliding with the wall. The system works now, but the particles stop spawning off screen. To fix this, we place down a link visible trigger and set it to group 5. Put the particle trigger, object spawning particles, and an object that will be on the screen to group 5. Now everything works perfectly. Now we can head over to the triggers to change values, especially the spawn particle trigger. Test out different settings to see what kinds of results you can come up with. You can also stop the particle spawn loop by pausing group 3. For some reason, stopping does not work, but pausing does. Spawning group 3 then resumes the loop. Now on to adding more variation into the mix. A very simple way is to move the collision blocks that move the particle spawner. You can also make any kind of shapes with more collision blocks that simply move the spawner in a different way. In my case, I'm making a new collision block ID and then moving the spawner to the right whenever it collides with it. Another thing you can do is use the random triggers to spawn different types of particles. Just assign it to the loop and make it spawn the spawn particle triggers. Copy the particle trigger and change their groups and match them in the new spawn particle triggers. I'm just spawning different textures here, but you can change the size, position, and rotation however you please. You can also do the exact same thing, but to randomize the color of the particle instead. Now, the end result looks something like this. Another way to change the generation is to move the spawner in a different way, instead of just to the right. Now we have stripes going gently down. Let's change it to make only the stars spawn in a wider Y area and make them bigger and more opaque. You can change the start and end alpha of it to 0.2 for example. Finally, we can also rotate the spawner around the center object instead of moving it. Remember to untick multi-trigger if you want it to only trigger when you start the system. Now we have a circle. Cool. We can quite easily make it into a spiral by adding a move trigger with the target mode enabled and set to the center. Tick dynamic mode on as well so the position updates every frame, and now we have a spiral. Alright, now we move on to the final part of the tutorial. Head over to the particle trigger. You can change pretty much anything you want, so go ham. The only important thing to remember is keeping lifetime and duration the same. You can mess with them too if you want, but I found that to work the best. Changing the values in the motion tab is how you'll create the particle motion. You can also add multiple objects to spawn particles in. Here I have two objects rotating in a circle, both spawning the same particles with some movement in them. You can also use keyframes for the spawner's movement. Here I have the same particle system moving in a loop around keyframes with some scaling to go with them. When scaling, you have to scale the particle trigger, not the spawner. Let's go over one more example. Here I made bubbles have a slow upward movement and I made them last longer than the other particles. There's not really that much more to it. Now before I tell you to go out there and use this perfect technique, I must tell you some of its limitations. First of all, spawning a lot of particles has a big impact on performance. My FPS goes from around 4000 to less than 1000 very quickly. That's why stopping the particles from spawning is essential. Having a short lifetime on the particles definitely helps, which makes the advanced section of the technique more usable. It's also quite slow at generating a background, for example, which means you'd have to somehow hide it while your level generates a background. Also, the particles cannot be moved or rotated or otherwise manipulated after spawning. They can have some movement on their own, but you cannot move them as a collective, so using this for parallax-like effects is impossible. That's it, thank you for watching the entire video. I appreciate it. I'm trying to hit 40,000 subs, so consider subscribing if you liked it. Also, thank you to my channel members, NotMorgo and Pyro Burnham. I don't post often, so it means a lot to me. Thank you. I hope I'll see some amazing creations with this technique from some of you talented individuals watching this. But that's it from me. I'll see you guys later. Bye bye.